Harper Audio presents I, Partridge, We Need to Talk About Alan, by Alan Partridge, with Rob Gibbons, Neil Gibbons, Armando Iannucci and Steve Coogan. This is Alan Partridge. 1. Beginnings. When I was 8 years old, I suffered a nosebleed so profuse and generous, I bolted from the schoolyard and sought solace in the first-class countryside of Norfolk. Nosebleeds were a pretty common feature of my childhood, caused variously by physical exercise, spicy food, bright sunlight, embarrassment, dairy, shouting, hearing or doing and fiddling with my nose. And my school friends were wise to it. More impressively, they'd worked out that they could induce a hemorrhage themselves by tethering me to the roundabout with the strap of my own school bag and letting the centrifugal force do the rest. Unbowed, I refused to accept this affliction and would sneak into the yard alone after school and subject myself to a few turns of the ride once or twice a week. This went on until I developed enough tolerance to prevent the bleeding at the age of about 16. But this nosebleed was hefty, brought on by a perfect storm of country dancing, hot weather, and the high pollen count. As it spread and dried on my face and neck, I knew I couldn't face the juvenile tittering of my class colleagues, which is how I came to wander the leafy idylls on the outskirts of Norwich. Had this been 2011, I'd probably have returned to school with some oozies to give my classmates something to really laugh about. But this was a different and better time. So I walked through the countryside and I bathed in the majesty of nature in quite a mature way for an 8-year-old. It was quiet, peaceful. The only soul I encountered was a lady rambler who literally ran when I smiled at her. The bleeding was very profuse. Eventually, I found myself stood at the verge of a copse, directly in front of a tree. I didn't remember approaching it, but there I was, standing and gawping at a single tree. Why? I thought. Why this tree? What is it about this simple field maple that makes it stand out from the others? It's not the biggest, the strongest, the coolest, the best at PE. Why am I being hauled into the tractor beam of this tree, over and above the millions of other ordinary trees? Well, I guess it had a certain something. At ease with itself, and blessed with a gentle authority, it had class and spunk. Then it hit me, the thought. It's me, I exclaimed. I am that tree. I personify its standout quality. Some people might say that's arrogant. Arrogant? Actually accurate. What has made me different from the others? How, and these were pretty much my exact words, even at the age of 8, did I come to be born with this aura of otherness, this je ne sais quoi? I stood and looked at the tree, and thoughts tumbled around my head like trainers in a washing machine. What made me thus? What made me thus? What made me thus? And as the memories swirled around, like the trainers I mentioned in the previous paragraph, all that could be heard was the pitter-patter of blood. My nose was still piddling the stuff, as it dripped from my nose and chin and onto my shoes. Pitter-patter, pitter-patter, pitter-patter. Pitter-patter goes the rain on the window. Pitter-patter, pitter-patter. And outside, cars zoom up and down the road, some of them dropping down into second to turn right into Gayton Road. On the pavement, people hurry and scurry, both to and fro. A clap of thunder, bam! And some really gusty wind. Everyone agrees it's a pretty dramatic evening all round. Pan right, it's a hospital room. A clammy, pregnant woman lies spread-eagled on the bed and is about to produce pitter-patter of her own. She's not going to wet herself, although that's often a distressing side effect of childbirth. I'm referring to the pitter-patter of children's feet. Stand back, says the midwife. Her contraptions are massive. Get ready. Looks like Anthony Eden's about to be named Prime Minister, mutters a nurse as she strolls past the door. And Chelsea are about to win the First Division title, replies an orderly, almost certainly not educated enough to follow politics. In the corner of the room, Rock Around the Clock by Bill Haley blasts from the radio, quietly. You see, this wasn't now, it's then. The present tense used in this passage is just a literary device so that this next bit comes as a surprise. The scene is actually unfurling in 1955. The hospital, the Queen Elizabeth Hospital in King's Lynn, the sweaty woman, Mrs. Dorothy Partridge, my mother, and the child's head slithering from her legs. It belongs to me. The child was I, Partridge.
"You've done it. Brilliant pushing,"
says the midwife. She holds the newborn aloft like a captain lifting a fleshy World Cup, and then the child throws back his head and roars the roar of freedom. The noise is relatively nonsensical, but no less intelligent than most babies would produce. In fact, probably a bit more switched on than average. In many ways, the proud wail that burst from my lungs was my first broadcast, delivered to an audience of no more than 8. That's still equated to an audience share in the delivery room, at least, of a cool 100%. Not bad, I probably thought. Not bad at all. As I write these words, I'm noisily chomping away on not one, but 2 muddy mints. I've a powerful suck, and soon they'll be whittled away to nothing. But for the time being, at least, they have each other. For the time being, they are brothers. Which is more than can be said for me, for I was an only child, and I will now talk more about being an only child. Why my parents never had more kids, I don't know, though as a youngster I'd often lie in bed wondering. Maybe it was financial reasons. Maybe I'd bust Mum's cervix. Maybe Dad had just perfected the withdrawal method. But I would have loved a little brother to play football with or bully. I'd rush downstairs every Christmas and rip open my presents, hoping against hope that one of the boxes contained a human baby. It rarely did. In fact, it never did. The sad fact was my parents, brackets though not communists, were unconsciously adhering to the same one-child-only policy espoused by the People's Republic of China. And like billions of Chinese children, I consequently had to endure a home life of intense loneliness. This meant there was extra pressure on me to be sociable. I didn't have a motto growing up, but had I done, it would almost certainly have been, "I'd love some friends, please," but maybe in Latin. I'd look on with longing as my fellow children greedily enjoyed their friendships. I remember being especially jealous of a lad called Graham Rigg. Graham was too cool for school, though he did still attend. He'd not only been winner of the Sports Day slow bicycle race for 3 straight years, he was also the first boy in our class to properly kiss a girl. There'd been cheek pecks before, not to mention intersex handshakes, but he was the first kid in the playground to go French. None of the rest of us could figure out where he'd learnt to do this, but the general consensus was, from porno films. 8-year-old Jenny Lancashire was the cock-a-hoop recipient, and she was rightly grateful. But when I look back, I often think how fortunate it was that Graham was the same age as her, because if he'd been 20 years older, he would have been up in Crown Court, and quite right too. I bumped into him for the first time in decades the other week. He was at the returns desk in my local home base. We were both taking back kettles, him, faulty filament, me, didn't like colour. "Still French kissing 8-year-olds," I said, pointing an accusing finger at his potentially paedophilic mouth. "No," he replied. "Good," I said. Then, for extra emphasis, I said it again, but slightly more slowly. "Good." I'd made my point. Anyway, after that, talk naturally turned to motor vehicles, and I was bowled over to learn that Graham had been the first person in Norwich to own a car with a catalytic converter. From playground Lothario to environmental trailblazer in under 50 years. It quickly dawned on me that here was a man whose number I needed to take. But before I had the chance, he'd collected his refund, mimed taking his hat off to me, and disappeared off into the sunset / down the paint aisle. Without love, parental or matey, to sustain me, I turned to myself, Alan Partridge, for comfort. Eager to keep myself occupied, I was, from a young age, deeply inquisitive. Learning was my friend, knowledge my bosom buddy. Indeed, in my quest for self-education, I once put a bumblebee in the freezer. It was to see if I could freeze it and then bring it back to life. I couldn't. Of course I couldn't. It was dead. I put it in a matchbox, like a kind of biodegradable bee casket, then just chucked it in the bin. I never told my mother. And so this young, neglected, but resourceful young man would guzzle down knowledge like kids would guzzle down fizzy pop, or full cream milk, either works. For a time I was fixated with butterflies, an interest that my father did much to encourage. We'd go into the garden on a summer's eve, and when we saw the gentle flitter-flutter of a butterfly, he'd smash it to the ground with his tennis racket. 15 love, he'd roar. Either that or some other tennis-related phrase. "Advantage, Dad," was my favourite. "You know what you need to do now, Alan," he'd continue. Yes, Father, I'm to collect the remains, piece them back together, and do my utmost to identify the genus. Sometimes I could actually do it too, but more often than not, particularly when Dad used his textbook backhand slice, he would have needed dental records to identify the dead. Still, world-class interactive learning. But don't be deceived by this seemingly intimate tale of fatherliness. In fact, I probably shouldn't even have put that bit in. No, above all else, overriding everything, was the dark heart at the core of my parents' parenting, which meant that, as I think I've said, my home life was one of neglect and sadness. Mother was cold, distant. After school, between the ages of 13 and 14, I would routinely have to let myself into the house where I'd be on my own, unfended for a minimum of 45 minutes, before she came home from working in a shoe shop. She'd try to console me by gifting me the latest shoe cleaning merchandise, and to this day I've always had an affection for shoe trees and shoe horns. And then there was Father. Like most men of his generation, he'd returned from the war a changed man. He'd signed up on the day of his 17th birthday. "Mum," he'd said chirpily, "I'm off to save a Jew or two." It was April 1943, and he'd had quite enough of the idiots with the swastikas, and they were idiots. I remember asking him once over breakfast what it had been like, but his eyes glazed over, and he just took another bite of his boiled egg. It was a bite that seemed to say, "Son, I don't want to talk about war, because I've seen soldiers decapitated like in Saving Private Ryan. The only soldiers I want to talk about are the ones I dip in my boiled egg, which coincidentally has also been decapitated," his next bite seemed to add. This was typical of my dad, or would have been if he'd said it, because he'd often have dark thoughts rounded off with a little joke. He wasn't an easy man, though. Mum said he came back from the war with a rage that never went away. She said he was still just very angry with Mr. Hitler. Yet it was me that suffered the consequences. Let's just say, Papa had a hand like a leather shovel. What made it all the more galling was that it wasn't even me that had carried out the final solution. The closest I've ever got to the extermination of the Jewish race was teasing John Malik about his big nose, but A, I didn't even know he was Jewish, and B, it was pretty large. You could have hung your washing off it. They say your nose is one of the few things that keeps growing throughout your life. John will now be 56. Good God. The only thing that softened the blow, metaphor, was that I was at least being beaten with a degree of excellence. My father was a naturally gifted corporal punisher. The quality of the blows was always the same, whether administering them with his right hand or his left, whether he was alone or had Mum screaming at him to stop, whether we were in the privacy of the home or out at a charity treasure hunt organised by Round Table. I couldn't wait for the day when I was big enough to turn round and thump him in the tummy or set fire to an Airfix Messerschmitt and put it behind his bedroom door so he'd be intoxicated by the burning plastic. You see, it wasn't just physical abuse. The torment was sometimes psychological. I still bear the mental scars from him trimming our privet hedge and then making me go round and collect the cuttings in the rain. Well, I've got a saying. Be careful what you do, because someday something similar might happen to you. And you know what? It did. Because financial difficulties in later life meant he ended up as a casual labourer in his 60s. I allowed myself a wry smile at that. You may think it's cold of me to be glad of his occupational misfortune, just because he had me collecting privets. But let me tell you this. He made me do it 4 times in as many years. And on another occasion, he made me clear out the garage on a sunny day. But I never have turned round and thumped him in the tummy or set fire to an Airfix Messerschmitt before putting it behind his bedroom door so he'd be intoxicated by the burning plastic. Why? Well, I guess resentment fades with time. Also, he's now dead. And the last thing I've got time to do is exhume and subsequently duff up the cadaver of a loved one. That'd be a heck of a lot of paperwork for one. Plus, I really need to take the car in for a service. I must do that next week. "Ah, but at least your parents didn't split up," you might be crowing. "You're lucky in that respect, Alan." I shake my head slowly and smile. You see, my parents' marriage wasn't as stable as their long list of wedding anniversaries might suggest, and that in itself was unusual and upsetting. Of course, these days, the institution of marriage is in crisis. It's crumbling like an OXO cube. I don't have the exact figures to hand, but it's probably correct to say that half of all marriages end in separation. Take the royal family. Elizabeth and Philip, solid as a rock.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.